Welcome back. You're watching Big Deal, and we have Sanjeev Jha right here with us. Sanjeev, so we were talking about the investor sentiment. So you've spoken to so many of them while presenting all these equity issuances. And what really worked in favor of SBI, because of which it is really a big success? First, tell us about that.
So I think, Nisha, I mean, talking specifically of SBI, I mean, again, as you're aware, the management has done a fantastic job in the last 3 years. Whether it be managing the whole NPA situation at the bank, whether it be building a very, very differentiated and strong retail portfolio, whether you look at the value they've created in all the subsidiaries, including the insurance businesses, and of course, you know, a large technology and larger and parallel technology platform. So I think those are the key themes that worked very well for SBI. Right. Of course, it does remain a big proxy for India as a whole. Right. So it always attracts that kind of attention. But I think overall, to your point, I would say investors still remain very, very discerning about quality and about backing the right names. And we should be cautious of that, that, you know, not everything will sell. I think these
are not
markets where everything will sell.
We have seen that kind of a market in the past where every paper sold. This is not the investors.
I think investors learned their lessons from 2009, where I would say we had that kind of sentiment where all deals were doing well. But I think over the last 24 months, investors have been very, very wise in choosing the right names, the right quality names they want to back. And that's why you see this, you know, string of IPOs that have done well, everything's performed well. QIPs that have traded well in the post market. So I think that is the big difference between, you know, what we have now versus what we had 7 years back.
Yeah, but it will also be wrong to say that it's only the financial services sector of big PSU or banking names which are doing well, because we have a list of equity issuances in some form or the other. We've even seen big blocks from Dalmia Bharat, from Petronet, and from Capital First, apart from Hindalco QIP, which was also a success. So it has been broad-based, but investors are choosy, is what you're saying.
I think, see, that again links to our call of we seeing a sustained capex revival. And I think when that happens, things like financials or cement, they tend to be at the forefront of that. They tend to be lead indicators of telling you that the economy is coming back. And therefore, the first string of QIPs is from these sectors. But as you said, as we go forward over the next 12 to 18 months, it'll definitely broad-base even more. And you'll see companies from more diverse sectors, as I mentioned, to come to the markets.
So you said that there is a strong demand from both FIIs and domestic institutional investors. So have we also broad-based the entire basket of investors? Are there new investors also coming in with their appetite?
So that's a great question. And I think that is the big difference I see in deals that we are doing this year versus 12 months back. So, you know, you now have, in the international community, you have sovereign wealth funds that are buying Indian deals. You are, as I said, you have the highest quality, what we call long-only investors that are buying. These are the largest institutions in the world. But I think within these institutions, we are no longer selling only to the India-dedicated PM or the emerging market-dedicated PM. We are reaching out and getting demand from a much wider cross-section of portfolio managers. You know, people who run global money, people who run global sectoral money. Those are the kind of people that have bought some of these recent deals. And I think that is the big change. Obviously, the smart money managers continue to like India. I think they've had a great run in India in the last 6 months. So those that demand also comes. And on the domestic side, as I said, I mean, the kind of inflows they've had over the last 6 months, I mean, the numbers are in the public domain. So they've, you know, again, if you go back 18 months back, they would buy about 20% of an Indian deal. These days, you can allocate easily about 40% to a domestic to domestic investors. So I think those are the two big changes we've seen in deals this year versus, let's say, 12 months back.
All right. So very important points made. But which geographies are putting in more money? Investors from which geographies are coming in more?
I think, Nisha, to that, I would say U.S. remains the, you know, the biggest contributor to deals. And I think that's true globally.
How is Europe?
Europe's been where it was, let's say, 2 or 3 years back. But I think the U.S. flows has actually increased significantly into deals in the last 12 months. And I think that, again, is a trend we think will sustain, because that's where the global money is based. That's where the biggest decision makers are based. And, you know, as you go forward, even our companies are now reaching this kind of size and scale, which now get in the, you know, which fall under the purview of some of those really senior portfolio managers who can invest money into those companies. So I think going forward, US will continue to be a very important region for us in terms of capital flows.
All right. So new investors also coming in. And that brings me to my next question, that since so much of equity issuance has already happened, we listed out so many of them, and so many big IPOs are also pending in the pipeline, is there enough appetite currently for more equity issuances right now?
So, you know, Nisha, I think you just only go back 5 years and you look at long-term averages. India used to raise about $20 billion of equity capital every year. We're not even half of that, even this year, despite the great flow we've had. So it's important to put one thing in perspective. Our economy size has only grown in those last 5 years. And of course, the global liquidity situation has only got better. I think we, at least I personally, haven't seen better liquidity conditions that I'm seeing right now. So therefore, I don't subscribe to this theory that more supply from primary issuances is actually going to have an impact on how our secondary markets are doing. I think there's enough liquidity chasing, and I think for the right quality names, it shouldn't be a problem. There'll be enough and more investor demand for the right names.
So we've spoken a lot about the equity issuances, but how is your debt side of the business doing? Are there enough issuances in the pipeline? You've done a few of them, like Adani Ports, ICICI Bank, SBI, as far as bonds are concerned.
So I think if you look at the macro picture, I think we've seen a big move away from only relying on the Indian banks for borrowing to the bond markets, whether it be domestic or international. And I think Indian companies have found a tremendous response in the offshore bond markets, mostly in the US dollar markets. That's where they've borrowed. And I think, which is again because those investors haven't had a chance to own Indian bond paper from Indian corporates. So I think we expect, again, that trend to continue. I think supply from the Indian corporates this year has been a little muted compared to the last 2 years. I think that will pick up. And I think you'll have more and more Indian issuers accessing that bond market, especially as bond spreads become even more competitive, so prices have come off. And B, also the swap cost, which is a factor for all Indian corporates to move from US dollars to INR, has also moved in our favor. So I think as a combination of these two or three factors, I think that's a market which will continue to gain a lot of momentum, and you'll see plenty of more Indian issuers tapping the dollar bond market.
All right. So my final question on the overall scenario. So much of fundraising is happening, Sanjeev. What are you hearing? A lot of them, the block especially, have been for giving exits to a financial investor and sometimes for refinancing purposes. But where is the growth capital? Because a lot of euphoria is also being built by the markets, because a lot of fundraising is happening and probably that will go into finally investments also picking of up and growth capital getting created. So what is the sense on that from your perspective?
I'll just go back to my earlier answer. I thought, you know, when we started the this primary cycle, some of the blocks were getting done, maybe some of the smaller IPOs were getting done. But if you just look at the last 6 to 12 months, QIPs coming back to the market is actually, as I said, a big lead indicator of the economic activity picking up, because these are listed companies that are all raising primary capital and they're all positioning themselves to play the next phase of growth. So these QIPs, and in the size that we're talking about, I think just between these four issuances, we've raised just under $5 billion. So I think that tells you that, I think from an economy perspective as well, over the next 6 to 12 months, we are headed for much better on in terms of capex cycle, and I think that should start showing up in GDP numbers. And also keep in mind the, you know, the structural reforms I spoke about earlier, whether it be GST. I think all of those things over the next 6 to 12 months should be a huge positive for the economy as well as the markets.
All right, so that's a very good indicator coming in from the deal street. And of course, this year you'll be very busy with all the equity issuances.
Absolutely,
all right, all the best to you and your team. Thanks, Sanjeev, for joining us on Big Deal. So that was Sanjeev Jha of Bank of America Merrill Lynch. But don't go anywhere. On the other side, we have some more thoughts coming in from the deal street. And also, don't forget, IndusInd Bank in the midst of a large transaction. So hear out Romesh Sopthi on the M&A strategy of the bank.